It's my pleasure to introduce Jane K. Cleland, who writes both fiction and nonfiction, including the multiple award-winning Josie Prescott Antiques Mysteries from St. Martin's Press and the Alfred Hitchcock Mystery Magazine, and the Agatha Award-winning bestsellers, Mastering Suspense, Structure and Plot, and Mastering Plot Twists from Writer's Digest Books. The book most pertinent to today is Jane Austen's Lost Letters, the 14th book in the Josie Prescott series, which will be published in December. So we're getting a sneak peek. Jane is a member of the full-time faculty at Lehman College, part of the City University of New York, a contributing editor for Writer's Digest magazine, and the chair of the Wolfpack's Black Orchid Novella Award, in partnership with Alfred Hitchcock Mystery Magazine. She is a frequent workshop leader and guest author at writing conferences, association meetings, and MFA residencies. Also, Jane offers free monthly virtual workshops on the craft and business of writing and Mystery Masterminds, a series of small group virtual workshops. More details are available at her website, janecleland.com. Jane has been generous enough to donate signed copies of Jane Austen's Lost Letters to give away. So I would like to kick things off by giving a copy to the first three registrants for today's meeting: Kirk Companion, Nikki Rad, and Michael Woodward. Congratulations. Please email your address to me at jasnanewjersey@gmail.com. And again, I'll post that into the chat. And you'll receive a signed copy of Jane Austen's Lost Letters from the bookstore The Poisoned Pen. And now, please join me in welcoming Jane Cleland.
Thank you all so very much. It's a pleasure to be here and to talk to you about Jane Austen's Lost Letters. I just want to clarify, I understand that your chapter has arranged with Poison Pen for several of the signed copies, and that's what you're going to be using as the giveaway. So yes, thank you so much. That's just delightful. Here's the, just so that you can see it, here's the book itself. And it's nice, right? It's a nice cover. Let me start by explaining my relationship with Jane Austen. I'm going to change the view here. Here we go. I come by my affection for her, honestly. My mother was a devoted fan, a member of this association for decades, the Boston chapter. She attended many meetings and conferences. Her favorite, I think, partially because of the train ride to get there, was in Lake Louise, Canada. She just couldn't stop raving about that experience. My mother wanted to share her greatest pleasures with me, starting with the unborn me. She played classical music, ate a lot of fried chicken, ice cream, and tomatoes. I know, what a combination, right? But those are three of my favorite foods. Thank you, Mom. She also believed, she was herself a writer, her name was Ruth Chessman, and she believed that writing was the greatest calling. And she wanted to share with me, the unborn me, her love of Jane Austen. She read Pride and Prejudice, her favorite novel, to me in the womb. Nice, right? She wanted me to hear the words, the magnificent prose, to appreciate the insights, to enjoy the wit, to value exemplary work. Lest you think I'm exaggerating my mother's devotion to Jane Austen, I will tell you that I'm named for her. I wrote this book because of a wonderful librarian named Jane Murphy. I know Jane often attends these meetings, and if you're here, hello, Jane. Jane used to be the librarian, a librarian in Westport, Connecticut, retired to the Finger Lakes region in beautiful upstate New York, and is a good friend. We were having dinner one night, and I was discussing, explaining, mentioning the difficulty in finding an antique worthy of writing a book about. And she said, and I'm quoting, "Jane Austen's letters," to which I replied, And I thought about it, and it clicked, and a little plot began to develop, and then a bigger plot, and then the characters came to be. And about 5 months later, I'm in Dallas at a conference, and I'm having breakfast with my St. Martin's publicist, Sarah Melnick, and I whisper the idea, the plot premise and the antique, and she just exploded with excitement. I mean, she literally leaped out of the booth and then ran back in and said, "Write that book." And so I did. So if not for Jane Murphy and Sarah Melnick, I don't know that this book would be written. And you'll see when you get a copy that it is dedicated to them. And of course, my darling husband, Joe. But without them, the book probably would not have come to fruition. You know, one of the things that happens in advance of publication is you get the reviews start coming out. And I'm going to blush as I tell you this, but I will. Publishers Weekly called it beguiling and said Miss Austen would approve. Miss Austen would approve. Isn't that incredible? So humbling. I'm just so pleased that they think that what I wrote was worthy of her. Once the preliminary plot and major characters are in place, the next step is the research. In addition to what I'm going to share today, I also researched Jane Austen's publishing history, her business model, events that occurred during the relevant time, and by relevant, I'm talking specifically between 1811 and 1814, which are the letters, that's the period in which the letters are written that I write about in Jane Austen's Lost Letters. Her stationery choices, how to mix gall ink, her pens, her attitudes towards her nieces and nephews, and so on. I do a boatload of research for each book I write. I checked earlier today. I keep all the notes about the book I'm writing in a separate Word file, and all the links and all the citations and everything. I have just enormous diligence. I do enormous diligence, due diligence in keeping track of my notes so that if a copy editor at a later date ever queries any of my use of facts, I'm able to reference the particular citation. And that note document is 73 pages long. It's a lot of notes, right? A lot of notes. That all said, keep in mind I'm not a scholar. I don't need to know everything. I research what I need to know and then I stop when I figure it out. I do this level of research to add verisimilitude to my work. In other words, I use facts, but I write fiction. So I use historically accurate information to write fiction. What I thought I'd do today is tell you about some of the facts that informed the plot and the story, read you a brief excerpt so you can see how those facts translate into fiction, and then I'll open it up to your questions. Excuse me. I'll start by talking about Jane Austen's letters themselves and a few extra facts I discovered along the way that I found particularly fascinating. Ms. Austen, by any measure, was an inveterate letter writer. Scholars agree that of the more than 3,000 letters they estimate she wrote, only about 160 are extant that we know of. And that, of course, is the premise of the book. More about that later. Her letters help us gain insight into both her creative genius, and her life. We get to know her in a more intimate manner than would be possible through her novels alone. You know, I do a lot of guest blogs during the publication surrounding the months surrounding the publication of a novel. And it occurs to me that on, you know, of course, a much more humble scale, this is very similar because the questions the blog owners ask you are designed to offer insight into an author's process and life. And I love doing it. I'm doing several this fall as well. The actual publication date is December 14th, so in the few weeks before and after. I want to read you a paragraph from the preface of the 1892 edition of The Letters of Jane Austen, selected from the compilation of her great-nephew, Edward, Lord Bradbourne, that is, Jane's niece's Fanny's son. The book was edited by Sarah Chauncey Woolsey. Miss Austen's life coincided with two of the momentous epochs of history, the American struggle for independence and the French Revolution. But there is scarcely an allusion to either in her letters. She was interested in the fleet and its victories because two of her brothers were in the Navy and had promotion and prize money to look forward to. In this connection, she mentions Trafalgar and the Egyptian expedition and generously remarks that she would read Southey's Life of Nelson if there was anything in it about her brother Frank. She honors Sir John Moore by remarking after his death that his mother would have perhaps preferred to have him less distinguished and still alive. Further than that, the making of gooseberry jam and a good recipe for orange wine, they interest her more than the marchings and countermarchings, the maneuvers and diplomacies going the world over. In the midst of the universal vortex of fear and hope, triumph and defeat, while the fate of Britain and British liberty hung trembling in the balance, she sits writing her letters, trimming her caps, and discussing small beer with her sister in a lively and unruffled flat fashion, wonderful to contemplate. I love this analysis, and it provides a window into Ms. Austen's personality and view of the world. The reason there are only about 160 letters is because her sister Cassandra burned the rest when she, Cassandra, was 70, decades after Jane's death. She burned most of them. Additional ones were burned by other relatives later. No one knows why. According to her niece, Cassandra thought Jane was too, quote, open and confidential. But if that's the case, why didn't she destroy them all? Regardless, just as no one knows exactly how many letters escaped that fiery fate, no one knows how many are extant. Just because the world thinks 160 survived, what if there are one or two more, or a dozen more, that have been handed down or sold or tucked in miscellaneous boxes and left in an attic and so on? This is not idle speculation. In February 2019, only 2.5 years ago, the news broke, excuse me, the news broke that 6 lines that had been cut out from one of her letters had been found. 6 lines discovered after 200 years. Hello. It doesn't get much more exciting than that, and you can imagine that the speculation was wild that someone cut those lines out because they were titillating or astonishing in a bad way or embarrassing in some momentous way. They didn't. They weren't the least bit unseemly. They referred to laundry. Someone cut out 6 lines about laundry and preserved them. And then they surfaced 200 years later. I love that. I love this too. The next day after the news broke, the Daily Telegraph had published a headline that read, "Lost Letter Airs, Jane Austen's Dirty Linen in Public." How clever is that? Isn't that adorable? Just as Sarah Chauncey Woolsey wrote in the preface of the collected letters that I quoted earlier, most of Ms. Austen's letters focused on the minutiae of daily life. Some addressed business matters related to her publishing career, and others dealt with more significant personal issues, but most reflected the joy she derived in her personal life. Let me give you some examples. I'll start with a delightful mishmash to her sister, Cassandra. I should note that everything I'm going to read you are excerpts. Sloane Street, Thursday, April 18th, 1811. My dear Cassandra, I have so many little matters to tell you of that I cannot wait any longer before I begin to put them down. The badness of the weather disconcerted an excellent plan of mine, that of calling on Miss Beckford again. But from the middle of the day, it rained incessantly. Mary and I, after disposing of her father and mother, went to the Liverpool Museum and the British Gallery. And I had some amusement at each, though my preference for men and women always inclines me to attend more to the company than the sight. I really love that. Some of you may be familiar with a mystery author, Robert B. Parker, one of my favorites. He wrote the Spencer novels, Private Eye. And in one of the Spencer novels, Spencer says that he prefers to spend time with the things man made rather than the things nature made, to account why he lives in the city, not the country. Back to the letter. I bless my stars that I have done with Tuesday, but alas, Wednesday was likewise a day of great doings, for man and I took our walk to Grafton House. And I have a good deal to say on the subject. I am sorry to tell you that I'm getting very extravagant and spending all my money, and what is worse, I've been spending yours too. For in a linen draper's shop to which I went for checked muslin, and for which I was obliged to give 7 shillings a yard, I was tempted by a pretty colored muslin and bought 10 yards of it on the chance of your liking it. But at the same time, if it should not suit you, you must not think yourself at all obliged to take it. It's only 3 shillings 6 pence per yard, and I should not in the least mind keeping the whole. So I thought you'd want to know that 7 shillings a yard is about 22.50. Excuse me, in today's dollars. Three shillings, 6 pence, a little more than 11. A bargain indeed. While of course there's great variety in fabric quality and pricing, from my research in preparing for this presentation, adjusted for inflation, those prices are consistent with buying fabric in today's market. I thought that was interesting. So to continue with the letter, skipping a little bit. I liked my walk very much. It was shorter than I expected and the weather was delightful. Love to all. Yours affectionately, Jane. Next example is her offering writing advice to her niece, Anna. Anna sent a partial manuscript to Jane after complimenting a number of the characters and offering advice on the ideal length of a novel, roughly 6 times Anna's first section, about 288 pages. We run a little longer now. Austen advises avoiding cliches. She wrote, "I have only taken the liberty of expunging one phrase, bless my heart. It's too familiar and inelegant." Wonderful. And then, of course, there's Jane's marital advice to her niece, Fanny. The scholar Janet Todd wrote, "Fanny saw Jane as a close friend, seeking her advice on love and marriage when Fanny was considering her marital prospects. Despite Jane's singlehood, Fanny obviously recognized her aunt's wisdom and intellect. John Pemberton Plumpter was one such suitor whose merits were debated between the two women." Not only does this statement reveal a strikingly personal opinion of Jane's that may help explain her reasoning behind her own thwarted engagement to Harris Big Wither, but it probably helped convince Fanny too. She did not marry Plumpter, and it wasn't until after Jane's death that Fanny eventually married Sir Edward Knatchbull. The following letter was written between November 18th and November 20th, 1814. "And now, my dear Fanny, having written so much on one side of the question, I shall turn around and entreat you not to commit yourself further, and not think of accepting him unless you really do like him. Anything is to be preferred or endured rather than marrying without affection. And if his deficiencies of manner, etc., etc., strike you more than all his good qualities, if you continue to think strongly of them, give him up at once." Quite a trailblazing attitude during a time of arranged marriages. So those are some of the facts I ferreted out about the letters. Now let's turn our hand to fiction. It was hard deciding where to stop. There are so many wonderful letters, and I have so many magnificent examples, but that's where I thought it was a good stopping place. So we have one mundane everyday issues, we have one about writing, and we have one marital advice. The excerpt I'm about to read you comes from chapter 2 of Jane Austen's Lost Letters. It is part of the Josie Prescott Antiques Mystery Series. Josie is an antiques appraiser who uses her knowledge of antiques to solve crimes. The books are often reviewed as Antiques Roadshow for mystery fans. All you need to know for this excerpt to make sense is that a woman named Veronica Sutton, a stranger, shows up at Josie's business. She hands Josie a green leather box, saying she was a good friend of her father's. The woman, who's about 70, very elegant, then jumps in her car and drives away before Josie can ask anything else. Josie's dad died 20 years ago, and she and her father were very close, so she just doesn't understand how there can be this woman who was a good friend of his that she knew nothing about. It doesn't make any sense to her. Here's the excerpt. "I couldn't imagine what was inside the box. My dad had been an amateur photographer, a world traveler, and an inveterate correspondent. And he'd saved scores of favorite photos, souvenirs, and letters. But the plastic tubs where he'd kept his treasures were safely stored, among other memorabilia. After a minute, I realized that I hadn't moved, that I was in some kind of stupor, no longer thinking about his possessions, not thinking at all. I felt fuddled, as if I'd been jerked out of a deep sleep. I was a key turn away from learning something about my father, but I was torn, as hesitant as I was curious. I wanted to know, of course I did, but I was also scared to my kneecaps that whatever I'd find would disrupt my memories. Veronica Sutton had already thrown me for a loop. What if I was about to open a Pandora's box? I slid the key into the lock. It turned smoothly, culminating in a satisfying click. I lifted the lid and stared, too stunned to move. I blinked. It couldn't be, but there it was. On top of a padded envelope was a note-sized card. Sorry, was a note-sized white envelope. Unstamped. That had been addressed to me at my old New York City address. I recognized my father's graceful script. His handwriting is familiar as my own. My heart pounded against my ribs, yet my body felt sluggish, as if I were slogging through knee-deep mud. I slowly drifted into autopilot, ready to cope, as I always did. In some remote corner of my mind, I knew I'd fall apart after the crisis passed. My modus operandi. With trembling hands, I turned the envelope over. My father had handled this paper. Wild ideas of steaming the flap open so I could preserve his DNA to keep the last little bits of him close flicked through my brain. I slid it open and eased the note card out. The handwritten message read, "Hey, Josie, you're not going to believe what I found. I was poking around a shop in New Hampshire, Portsmouth, up and ended up buying a portfolio of sketches. Wasn't until I got back to my hotel room that I saw two letters in the mix. Trust me, you're going to be happy. I'll get them into archival sleeves and give them to you when we have dinner on Tuesday. Can't wait to see you." I clutched the note to my chest, gold and silver flecks dancing before my eyes like slow-moving confetti. My dad was referring to a dinner we'd never eaten. The dinner scheduled for September 11th, 2001. "Sorry, you're talking to a New Yorker here. Yes, I was in the city on that day, and I waited 20 years to write about it." His note ended, "Love you, Dad," followed by a PS. "I can't find a stamp. Never mind. I'll hand this to you in person next week." I set it aside, breathless, weak. Suddenly parched, I drank some water, then sat quietly for a few seconds. When I felt more poised, I removed the padded envelope. Below it were two transparent plastic sleeves, each protecting a letter written on personal-sized stationery. I picked them up, tilting them toward my desk lamp. The ink was brown, the paper yellowed. One letter was dated 1811, the other 1814. The first bore the salutation, "My dear Cassandra." The second, "Dearest Fanny." I squinted to read the signatures, and when the name came into focus, I gasped. Jane Austen. I dropped the plastic sleeves as if they were on fire, then stared at the name. Could my father really have found two previously unknown letters written by one of the world's most beloved authors? No way. Absurd. I reached to pick one up, saw I was trembling, and grasped the edge of the desk to steady myself. A minute later, a bit calmer, I eased the plastic-encased letters toward me and studied the handwriting. The script was elegant, the letters well-formed, with period-appropriate clarity. When a lowercase d ended a word, long left-leaning swashes embellished the ascender. In Cassandra's letter, the words "lend" and "changed" included the swash. In Fanny's, the swash adorned "need" and bind. I read the 1811 letter. The tone was chatty and witty, filled with amusing descriptions of the minutiae of home life, written while Cassandra, Jane Austen's sister, was off visiting relatives. Jane spoke of her success at BiblioCatch. I'd had a similar toy when I was a kid. I still owned it, and I played it occasionally. The modern American version was called Cup and Ball. A wooden cup sat atop a wooden spindle. A wooden ball, sized to fit snugly inside the cup, was attached to the spindle by a string. The idea was to let the ball dangle, then swing it up into the cup, leaning it cleanly in one motion. Jane boasted that she'd made the shot 98 times in a row. My record, which I thought was decent, was 9. Jane also discussed playing spillikins, what we call pickup sticks, and putting up blackberry jam. She mentioned gussying up a hat and cabbage pudding and vegetable pie she'd eaten for lunch. She also included a scathing review of Rachel Hunter's novel, later Lady Macallan, the victim of villainy. In the review, Jane referenced the book she'd written in 1791, The History of England from the Reign of Henry IV to the Death of Charles I, by a partial, prejudiced, and ignorant historian. She joked that she was less ignorant now, but just as prejudiced. According to Jane, Lady Macallan, the victim of villainy, was verbose and overly melodramatic, yet she confessed she'd enjoyed it hugely. I laughed. Apparently, Jane Austen had enjoyed trashy novels, just like the rest of us. She ended with, "Yours very affectionately." The tone in the 1814 letter was quite different, less frivolous, more serious. Fanny, Jane's niece, who would have been 21 at the time, was considering marrying a man she didn't love. Jane started by summarizing Fanny's description of Mr. S, stating that she couldn't believe Fanny would consider marrying a man where the best she could say of him was that he was the eldest son of a good family, that there was nothing repulsive about him, and that she was certain he would be a kind husband, neither tyrannical nor oafish. Jane wrote, "Anything is better than marrying where there is no attraction. You don't need to despise the man you marry to become an object of pity. Mild affection will take the trick. Better to live in poverty or endure the contempt of your friends and wrath of your family than bind yourself to a man you cannot admire. Know that I do not speak without experience." The letter ended, "Yours affectionately." I couldn't believe what I was seeing. The ramifications were simultaneously humbling and overwhelming. Under normal circumstances, I'd dash downstairs and run through the warehouse to the front office, where I'd screech and shout and do my happy dance, the one I performed when I was euphoric, too jubilant for words. But this circumstance, where the letters had been delivered with a message from the grave, my father's grave, was far from normal. I touched the plastic sheathed letters, awestruck, dumbfounded. As the magnitude of this offering sank in, this package really, truly had come from my father. The maelstrom of emotions left me reeling, grappling for safe harbor as if I were on a dinghy in rough waters. Thank you. It would now be my pleasure to answer your questions.
All right, thank you very much for that. Okay, so we are taking questions in the chat. Just type your question right in, and I will pose it to Jane. While you're gathering your questions, we do have a couple more signed copies of the book to give away. So using a random number generator, I have come up with our first winner, and it is, or our first winner of this part of the program, I should say. And it is Mary Jane Sinclair. So congratulations, Mary Jane Sinclair. You can email me your address at jasnanewjersey@gmail.com and we'll get it out to you. Okay. And our next winner is also going to be, using our random number generator, Elizabeth Cognata. Elizabeth Cognata. So congratulations to you as well. So Jane, was there anything through your research about Jane Austen's letters that, particularly surprised you?
Yes, very much so. And let me just type, lots of info is available on my website. And I'm just going to type it in there for you all. And I'd welcome you to come and say hello there. I can type. Surprised me. Lots of things surprised me in the letters. I was surprised at her consistent cheerfulness. She had a joie de vivre, a joy of living that is, I think, in many ways a surprise for authors. And now why do I say that? I know a lot of authors, and I would say that many people who try to understand human nature, who dig a little below the surface into why people do things, which you have to do in order to write characters that resonate, aren't necessarily able to present themselves to their so consistently as lighthearted and friendly and warm and empathetic. And that really struck me. What a remarkable woman she must have been.
And Mira Rao is asking, what resources do you use for your research?
I'll answer that in several ways. On some level, I like doing research more than writing. And research is an absolute rabbit hole that once you go down, it can consume you forever. And therefore, I really have to be very disciplined not to do unlimited research. I try hard to find primary sources. So that what I mean by that, primary sources is the original. Like I read you a paragraph from the prologue of that book, not someone else blogging about that book, for example. That would be secondary research. A lot of the authentication process that Josie has to go through to discover whether these letters are genuine or not is quite technical. And so for that, I went to technical sources. For example, the J.P. Morgan Library, which if any of you ever get to New York, is definitely worth a trip. It's a wonderful, wonderful, it is a library. Mr. Morgan's original books are there. They have two copies of the Gutenberg Bible. They have Beethoven's original handwritten music. It's an astonishing collection. But they also have many rotating exhibits. They own 51 of Jane Austen's letters. And they do enormously detailed and meticulous scholarly work on the validation, the authentication, and so on. And they have on their website a long discussion of how they validated the letters. And that was enormously helpful to me in understanding how you do that without destroying the paper, the ink, and so on. I also, because I am part of the City University of New York, that I work for them. I have access to their library. And of course, you can imagine 24 campuses, the City University of New York, the largest and greatest public university in the world, gives me a real leg up in doings. When I need scholarly research, I have access to all of that material. So what do? I ask specific questions in Google, and that gets me to specific places. And then I, as I said, I try to find the primary research. For example, I would never cite Wikipedia. Wikipedia is wonderful. I use it all the time for background. But because anyone can edit it, it can't be validated as true. And I have, in fact, discovered many errors on Wikipedia. But the source material at the bottom, that gets you to the primary sources. And that's what I use Wikipedia for. I even like talking about research. Want to know more? I'm glad to tell you.
Deborah Yaffe was wondering if you know how long ago the last complete, previously unknown Jane Austen letter was found.
2019, or that's that little snippet. In terms of the last unknown letter, I don't know that. That's a really good example of being only researching things I need to know. I didn't need to know it, so I didn't look it up.
Okay. Sherry Babish is asking, what do you think of Jane writing about liking a prospective husband rather than using the words loving him?
That's a great question, isn't it? I think, I mean, since you're asking my opinion, I will give you my opinion. I think the most important predictor of marital success is shared goals. That's me. That's my personal opinion, shared goals. I think it what gets people in trouble is when they don't talk about things like child-rearing habits or preferences, religion, politics. They just are motivated by affection and sex. When you have a lot in common and shared goals, I think affection is probably enough to make for a very happy marriage. But that's my opinion.
And Deborah has a follow-up question. Some readers have been shocked by some of the callous things Jane Austen wrote in her letters, such as a dead baby joke. Did you see anything in the letters that you found to be unpleasant or distressing or that made you like her a little bit less?
No, I didn't, because it just, those little things made her real to me. And she's talking to a confidant. When I read, I'm not going to remember the exact words, but I'm a wild woman. I'm wild and crazy. It's like, oh God, she'd be my friend. No.
I know you're just getting this book wrapped up and onto the shelves. Have you thought at all about your next novel and what antique you might focus on?
I'm actually working on something that's different. I'm working on what is considered women's fiction. Three women who all have reasons to kill someone. And what happens? I know that's not a very elegant description of it, but that I'm not, right now I'm not thinking of a Josie. I've written a short story that's not a Josie. But if I did another Josie, I can tell you what the antique would be. It would be Hearts. And the title would be Killer Hearts.
Okay. Oh, and Mira did have just a comment on your answer. She said it was an excellent answer on the love versus like. Her late father-in-law opened her eyes to the like versus love, and it makes so much sense to like a person that you want to live with for the rest of your life.
Yeah, you know, and when you're young, you don't really know the difference between infatuation and love, and lust and love. And, you know, I'm all for lust, I'm all for infatuation. It just has nothing to do with love. In my opinion.
Okay. Oh, Helen Nelson was asking, did writing a book about Jane's letters motivate you to handwrite letters to your friends?
I always have, and I have never stopped. I write a lot of notes. I'm one of those people that actually handwrites thank you notes. I handwrite notes about daily activity that to friend, specifically to friends who do not use email much. And I will tell you that Zoom is changing that. I have regular recurring conversations now on Zoom with faraway friends. I'm sure people do that with FaceTime and other technologies, Skype and so on. But it's fairly new for me in the last year or so. And it's wonderful. I like it better. So I'm already writing fewer handwritten notes.
Okay.
You might be interested, just thinking about the authentication process. So let me talk a little bit about that and how, when you're authenticating an antique, and this of course applies to the letters, and it may inspire a few other questions as well. Josie looks at rarity and scarcity. Rarity is how many were created or manufactured, crafted, produced. Excuse me. Scarcity means how many are extant. You also look at authenticity in terms of content. Is this the kind of subject matter that this person would write in a letter? Or is this table the kind of thing that craftsmen would have created? We then are looking at association. Was that thing owned by anybody that was important or interesting that adds extra value? Its condition, of course, matters. Is it normal wear and tear, or is it damaged because someone set a cup of coffee on it and coffee spilled, that kind of thing? Is it popular? Trends, there are trends in antiques like in everything else. So is it, if it's popular now, that might be a contributor to value. Does it have any historical significance? And then finally, past price. People who collect antiques who are new to the process, whether this is a collectible or an antique, and the definition Josie uses, which is standard in the industry, is 100 years. A collectible would be less than 100 years old. A common mistake is using only past sales price to predict future value. And that just doesn't hold the case at all. You know, antiques, it's one of the last bastions of pure capitalism. An antique or a collectible is worth what someone will pay for it, right? And that is determined by what its value is to me. If I have the most important collection of thimbles, that's a subplot in this book, thimbles of a certain kind, then if you have one that will complete my collection, it's worth a whole lot more to me than it might be to someone else. It's one of the factors that matters, not everything.
Okay, Lenny Granger is asking, do you think Cassandra was not eager to let the world hear Jane in her letters because she was assertive, outspoken, and full of opinions? Cassandra was Jane's straight man, if you will, and felt she had to control Jane's legacy.
I think she clearly felt she had to control the legacy. I don't disagree with the premise of your question, but it doesn't answer the question, why did she allow any to survive? It doesn't make any sense, because some of the ones that survived were really quite assertive and contained those "I'm wild and crazy" comments or other things that, if you're trying to protect her, you wouldn't have let survive. I think it's quite mysterious.
And Mira is asking, how did your language change to suit Austen's style? Did you find an enormous difference between American versus British English? Was it more natural for you to being an Austen fan, or did it require study?
You should have met my mother. my mother was a walking dictionary. There was never a word I asked her what it meant that she did not know. She was also a complete Anglophile. And so I grew up in the Boston area with a love of all things British, with a mother who had a vocabulary like you wouldn't believe and understood the nuance of word. I'll give you one example. I was about 10 and I came home from school saying, oh, there's a new girl in school. She just transferred in. She's really nice. And my mother turned to me and said, nice means discriminating. I assume you mean she has good taste. And I said, no, I meant she was chatty and friendly and seems like she'd be a lot of fun. And she said, better. How many people do you know that the word nice really means discriminating and has come to mean these other things? So, I've had it in my ear all along. I also really debated whether to attempt to write anything under Jane Austen's name. You notice in the letter about the cabbage pie and the bibliotech and so on, the bibliocatch thing, I did not pretend that she wrote it. It just seemed so arrogant. So how could I dare to even do such a thing? But the letter of advice really felt like it had to come from her. And so I read through the Guggenberg Project, all of the letters that she wrote containing marital advice. I studied those, and that, therefore, the one I wrote was adapted really very closely to her own wording. And I knew that Fanny had been considering a suitor who was known only as Mr. S. So I used a lot of facts and word choices. I studied her handwriting. That's how I knew about the swash. So that's all research based.
And Adina Bernstein says, her impression of Jane's nieces and nephews is that they were just as protective of their aunt's legacy as Cassandra was. Did you get that same impression?
Yes. Up to this current day. However, they let some letters survive. So it's a dichotomy, a paradox that, and now, of course, the relatives that are alive today don't have any direct knowledge. And the perpetrators of the destruction of the letters didn't explain their logic. No one, if they did, they didn't write it down. It has not survived.
Okay, now I know we're giving away signed copies of your book today. If somebody wanted to purchase a signed copy, is that something they're yes. able to do.
Yes, thank you so much. And I'm going to send them to Poisoned Pen Books in Arizona. Poison Pens is going to be sending me books to sign. And then I send them back to Poison Pen and they send them out to purchasers. So that would be wonderful. And I will tell you, with supply chain issues, which you've been hearing about everywhere, it is affecting the publishing world as well, with shortages in paper. So if you are going to buy the book, it is enormously helpful if you would pre-order it, whether you pre-order it from Amazon or you want to pay full price because you'll get it autographed from Poison Pen. But pre-ordering is enormously helpful to the author and to the publisher. So thank you for suggesting that. And Poison Pen is the keeper of the autographed ones.
Okay. Sherry actually just came in with another question about the number of letters. You said that 160 letters are extant, but it's estimated that Jane wrote 3,000 letters. What yes. evidence is the 3,000 estimate based on?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I did delve a little bit into that because I was so curious about it. Believe it or not, it's based on a geometric progression. They know how many she wrote during certain periods of time, and they did the math. If they know that, for example, if they knew that Cassandra was traveling during this period, and that typically Jane wrote daily or every other day, they can just do the math. And then they added some in for the nieces and nephews and so on. It's interesting, right? Yeah.
It really is. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, I think we are going to wrap things up with two more winners. We are going to give one of the signed copies to the two people who asked the first two questions. So that is Mira Rao and Sherry Bobish. So again, you can email us your address at jasnanewjersey@gmail.com. I will put that in the chat right now too. And there we go. All right. And thank you all very much, Jane, for joining us.
It's been a real pleasure. Thank you all so much.
All right. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.